Hearing voices.
Quiet, numbskulls, I'm broadcasting.
This is Hearing Voices. Conversations with the voices that bring the excitement of college sports alive.
No headphone can capture the complex bourbon and butter flavor of my actual timbre.
Now, here's your host, the voice of your Fighting Tigers, Chris Blair.
Welcome in, everybody. Yeah, it's another week. Hearing Voices. Hard to believe we are headed into the third week of the college football season, but what do you know? Here we are. Your Fighting Tigers 1-1 on the year. Started their home schedule this past Saturday. McNeese State rolling in from Lake Charles, and the Tigers, a little slow start, but eventually take care of business. 34-7 is the final. They are 1-1 on the year, and now they'll get ready for, well, a step up in competition. Let's say that. Central Michigan, Coach Jim McElwain and the Chippewas, they are headed here to Baton Rouge. 6:30 kickoff inside Tiger Stadium, and we certainly hope you'll be there. If not, we'll have it for you on the airwaves, as we always do. It is Hearing Voices. We are glad you stopped by our little show. This is where we talk to the voices you hear. If you scan the dial, if you're on a coast-to-coast ride, you can stream, you can hear it on satellite radio. A lot of ways to consume college sports these days. And we'd like to go inside the booth a little bit, behind the mic. How many more cliches can I throw at you? But that's what we try to do here on this show. So it's my pleasure to welcome the voice of the Central Michigan Chippewas. Yes, indeed, Adam Jaksa, our guest this week. Adam, thanks for joining us, man. Hope things, is it cool? Is it fall officially up there where you are right now?
Hey, Chris, it is indeed fall. So up here in Michigan, we get those lovely humid temperatures heading into the fall. So once we hit this time, a little bit cooler, lower 70s, and if it feels like football weather.
Well, I got news for you. This past weekend was actually what we felt like was a little bit of autumn. And, you know, we do have a little tropical depression, tropical storm coming in the next couple of days, going to dump some rain. And then I'm not sure, but, you know, this past weekend they said enjoy it while it lasts because it may be getting warmer. So maybe we can order up another second weekend in a row of autumn weather, but maybe a little warmer for you when you guys come south. But we certainly look forward to having you here. I got to believe, which we're going to talk about your background, how long you've been doing not only football, but broadcasting in general. But I got to believe coming to Tiger Stadium is got to be exciting, A, for the Chippewa football team, but probably B, for the Chippewa broadcaster.
Yeah, we're super excited. I mean, first ever meeting between the Chips and the Tigers, and, you know, we love playing against the SEC opponents. It's a big feel. Went to Missouri, and now we'll go to LSU. We've played Georgia and a couple others as well. So it's always cool when you go to one of the iconic stadiums, which Tiger Stadium is, and I know 100,000 plus in one stadium will be the most that I've ever called a game in front of, so I can't wait for it as well.
Well, don't tell anybody, but the truth is Georgia, Missouri, it's going to be a whole other world when you get here to Baton Rouge and Tiger Stadium. And the one thing I can guarantee, and I tell all the people that come here, and I've only been here 6 years, but the one thing I learned very early on is that even opponents will not go hungry or thirsty on their way in. So once you park and make your way towards the stadium heading up to the press box, make sure you sample some of the great cuisine here from South Louisiana and Baton Rouge, because they're going to offer it to you. Now, once you get in the stadium and the team gets in the stadium, they got nothing for you. But on the way in, they're very hospitable. So take advantage of it.
I was going to say, the only thing I've heard, Chris, and I've never been to Louisiana, I've never been, obviously, to LSU game, is that the fans, legendary tales, they're not so friendly to the opponents. And that's tales all the way from Coach Mack when he says entering into LSU, it's a different animal. So I'm kind of excited for that, to get some of that hostility. That's what football's all about, right?
Yeah, I mean, that's interesting because, as I said, you know, a lot of friends of mine in the business always say the very same thing, which is there's legendary stories of how rough the crowd can be to the visitor. And yet I have kind of self-appointed myself, Adam, to be the ambassador who says, not on the way in. On the way in, it is as nice as they can be, and it's really enjoyable. And come to find out, a lot of my friends publicly say it's a rough place, but privately they say we love coming to Baton Rouge and Tiger Stadium. So, but again, once the game starts, kickoff, boot meets ball, yeah, you don't want to be wearing anything other than purple and gold. Adam Jaksa is our guest. He is the voice of the Chippewas. They come down this weekend. And Adam, I want to dig back. You're a young buck. I mean, that's a compliment actually when you're my age. But you've been broadcasting for a while now, and you know, just reading up on your bio, I know you're a graduate. You're an alum of Central Michigan, and you started in the broadcasting for the Chippewas when you got there on campus. That had to be. I'm assuming that was something you wanted to do before you got on campus, and then to get the actual opportunity to do so, you got to feel very lucky.
Yeah, I do. I knew sports was going to be a part of my career or my lifestyle, I thought, when I was younger, and I actually got cold feet. I'm a former Division III soccer player, so I actually went D3 first and tried the engineering thing because I thought I liked math, and I thought, hey, it's not as competitive. And then I tried to take Calc 2, and I was like, no, this is why I wanted to be a sports broadcaster, because I don't know what I'm doing here. So I transferred up to CMU in 2011, and I knew about what a great program it was. I mean, Dick Enberg, of course, came out of there. You can go up and down all the names throughout the state of Michigan and all over the country, that whether they're TV broadcasters, weather people or sports broadcasters, just broadcasters in general, Central Michigan's got a really good program. So when I kind of put my mind to it and made the decision that I was going to go all in and go for sports broadcasting, I went to Central Michigan, and it was home for me and still is home. So to bring it full circle, yeah, it is special to me to be able to say, hey, I went to your broadcasting school. It helped me out a ton, and now I get to call games for your university. It's very exciting, and I really enjoy it.
Well, you are one of the lucky ones, and I imagine you probably have some, you know, undergrads who come to school who have the same hopes and dreams that you have to go into sports broadcasting, and of course they want to jump right into it, and who can blame them? And I get asked a lot, and I think this would be an interesting point to kind of discuss, of, you know, I want to get involved. I want to find a way to eventually get on the air. How do I go about doing that? So for you, it's a little bit different. For me, I actually just volunteered out of college and said, I'll do whatever anybody needs to do. I was doing high school football at a local radio station, but knew I needed to get the behind the scenes, you know, setting everything up and producing. So that's what I did when I just got out of college at Clemson University. But it helped me quite a bit to be able to go ahead and be able to kind of learn the background and how you, where this wire goes and where this cable goes and how it all is put together. But when they come to you and say, all right, this is what I want to do. I want to have your job in 35 or 40 years. What's the advice that you tell somebody young?
Say yes. As you just said, Chris, get all the experience and opportunities you can get and take them, because that's really what it's about. It's, as you know, about meeting people, building connections, and sometimes being in the right place at the right time. But it's also about being ready when that moment presents itself. And that's what I'm forever thankful for Central Michigan is. I think one of the things you look at one of these smaller schools, and there's a few really good broadcasting schools just within the MAC. You think of Ball State, and Toledo's got a good program. Of course, so does Central Michigan and a few others. You get to jump on the air right away up at Central Michigan, and a bigger school like a Syracuse or maybe some other places, I don't think they get those opportunities as easily. So that's what I loved, was the fact that you get to go out there, get your feet wet, and make mistakes and learn from them firsthand. So I think it's part of that is saying yes, volunteering, as you mentioned. Do you want to go call a game? Do you want to go engineer a radio broadcast? Do you want to be a sideline reporter? Do you want to do whatever it is related to this field? the more opportunities you get, the better, and the more people you meet along the way, the better. So it sounds like that's what you did, just in terms of getting those opportunities. That's certainly what I did, and that's what I'll continue to tell individuals that want to do this is it's really competitive, so you got to stand out, and you got to be ready when that moment presents itself, and I think you do that by taking advantage of the opportunities around you.
Really cool to have Adam Jaksa join us. He'll be here in Baton Rouge on Saturday along with the Chippewas calling the action. LSU, Central Michigan with kickoff at 6:30. Looking back, I wanted to touch on this a little bit because I find it very important. I know that when you started, once you arrived there on campus, you were given those opportunities. I kind of set this up for you. And one of the longtime voices, your predecessor, Don Shido, who was much beloved and just like you, an alum of Central Michigan, had called the games, I think, for a decade or so, tragically killed in an automobile accident, I believe, probably after the end of the season in December of 2019. That's a tough, tough, you know, role to jump into. You know, how did you handle that? Because to me, that it's bittersweet. I mean, you've got an opportunity to do something that you want to do, you love to do, and as it turned out, what you were born to do, and yet it comes to you in such very difficult situations. How did you best handle that, and how are you still handling that? I imagine it's still something that you have to go through.
Yeah, it was devastating. Don was a best friend, a father figure for me, and someone that gave me way more opportunities than I deserved. And I don't know, Chris, if you know any other play-by-play voices that would willingly step away on a football Saturday to give a young, dumb kid like me an opportunity to get football play-by-play reps, but that's what Don did for me. I mean, numerous times going back to 2017, he would step away for a game or two each season, knowing that, Adam, you got to build some tape, you got to get better, because eventually you want to get one of these positions. Now, I didn't know if it was going to be his or some other, but and he stepped away for big games. I mean, we played Miami, Florida down in Miami back in 2019, and no one in their right mind when you go to a mid-major school would say, hey, I'm going to give this game up and let someone else go do it, but that's who Don was. He was the most selfless individual, really, that I had ever met. So to bring it full circle, it was after the regular season, but, Chris, it was also 3 days before we played in our first MAC championship in a decade. We called the MAC West championship game, basically, against Toledo that Saturday. Chippewas got in for the first time since 2009, and we were headed to Ford Field. That Wednesday, he gets in a car accident, and Saturday is the game. So on top of all the emotions of losing someone that was so close to me, and really I'd never experienced death like that before. It's just something that was sprung upon you, and you don't expect it to happen. So with all of those emotions going on, then there was a football game that needed to be called, and then there's all the pieces moving forward. So, I mean, it's something that I still think about every day, just missing him and the fact that I'm so lucky that he gave me the opportunities and he let me learn from him and ask him questions, and we started to build a relationship outside of broadcasting, just talking to each other and just becoming people that enjoyed spending time with me, spending time with each other, rather. I hope he enjoyed spending time with me. I know him a lot sometimes, but I mean, it was really tough, and it was tough for me. It was tough for my football partner and analyst, Brock Gutierrez, because they had called games for 10 years. Our spotter, Steve Powers, best buddies with him, and everybody, obviously, in the Mount Pleasant and Central Michigan community, they had gotten used to Don Shido's voice, just as, you know, the LSU community has gotten used to yours. They relate Central Michigan football and basketball and athletics as a whole to that voice, and that was Don, and everybody loved him. He was a super witty and fun human being to be around outside of being on the mic, and once he passed away, it was just devastation. So I certainly still feel those moments where I wish he was here to have a conversation with him, or just simply talk Chippewa football or college basketball. But we think about him every day, and we're continuing to try and honor him on the broadcast and make sure we remember all the sacrifices and everything he gave to this university, to this athletic department. And, you know, we're never going to forget about Don Scheidel and what he did for us, what he certainly did for me, and everything he did for CMU as a whole.
That is an incredible story, because I got to be perfectly honest with you. To know that the voice of the Chippewas allowed you, as a youngster, you know, as you said in 2017, to go be able and just sit back and say, you go do this game because you need reps. I mean, wow. Salute Don Scheidel. I don't know, and I can't speak for everybody, but I don't know if there's anybody that has been willing to do that at the FBS level of football, for that matter, FCS or any football. I mean, that is unbelievable.
And it was every year. I mean, it started in 2017, but from 2017 and 2018 to 2019, it became one game, then it became two games, then it became three games. So it was something constant that I just couldn't believe, and I certainly didn't ask for it. I never was like, hey, can I do this game? You know, it's his job. I just was happy to be along for the ride and part of the team, but he would step away and say, you go do this game. You need the reps. You go do it. And I would just be, oh my gosh, yes, I can't wait. I can't believe you're giving me this chance, but I'm going to relish it and do everything I can to call a good game and, you know, go over the tape, get better, and learn from the moment.
Well, there you go. No wonder Don Scheidel so beloved by everybody who knew him at Central Michigan and beyond. One of the other things that's interesting is Adam Jaksa, who you can find on Twitter. Maybe he'll put some things out about the Chippewas this week, at Adam Jaksa. You kind of do this in reverse. So tell us about the broadcast you do, because I know you've done wrestling. You've probably done a number of the other sports outside of the Big Three, as somebody likes to call it. And then also you're doing minor league baseball during football season. As we know, those two seasons collide. You know, here at LSU, I've got a collision in November with football and men's basketball, and then a similar collision in February with basketball and baseball, which gives me a little time to get engrossed in football, then get ready for basketball, get engrossed in basketball, then get ready for baseball. You're taking on minor league baseball and football at the same time in early fall. My goodness, are you a glutton for punishment?
You know, Chris, you could just go behind the scenes and show the people the text exchange we had earlier today, where Chris, being the professional that he is, sent me a meeting invite back in July and said, hey, we're going to do this the third week, and I accepted. And then, of course, 24 hours before, I say, oh, wait, no, I can't do this, and we're trying to figure out a time between baseball, between football and meetings and all that. So it's a hectic schedule, and certainly I appreciate you working with me. But, yeah, I mean, just specifically this year with COVID and minor league baseball, one, we didn't have a season last year, and this year they pushed the season back a full month. So we actually didn't start until May, which means we're going to go a little bit longer. So typically we're done by Labor Day, but this year we're done 3 weeks into the season. This is 3 weeks into the football season. So this is my final week of minor league baseball. So it's been absolutely wild to do baseball and coming up on 120 games this year. And then, oh, by the way, here comes football season, and it's a lot of non-conference games at the beginning of the year where you're traveling down to Columbia, Missouri, down to Baton Rouge, Louisiana. So I love it, but as you know, in the broadcasting field, there's not a lot of time for rest. So here we are.
Yeah, no doubt about it. I mean, nobody's going to feel sorry for you if you go, hey, guys, I need a break because, you know, there's too many sports going on, because you and I both know we have two of the best jobs in the country without question. Television is something that you have done quite extensive work in television. And I usually ask my guests on here, because we've all done a little bit of radio, a little bit of TV, and some decide to stay with television, some decide to stay in both, and some go radio only. I'm one of those that, you know, I guess I'm just one of those that I don't want to listen to anybody else. I mean, I want to call the game. And when I got 19 people in my ear, it's just not something I enjoy. But for you, what do you like better? I mean, in 10 years, what do you want to be doing? You want to do radio? You want to do TV? You want to try to do both?
Yeah, I mean, I'd love to say I'll do both, and I think that's another learning lesson when you go back and you say, what do you tell a younger self or someone that's trying to get in this? Be willing to do both so you're more diverse, and that's always what I was told. So it is a little unique where I got TV experience more so before I got radio experience, just because that's the era of ESPN3 and ESPN+, basically when I graduated college. So that's how things worked out. But I like the challenges of both. I mean, certainly I think I've fallen in love with TV more than I thought I would, just because I've done it more. I really love the fact that you're working with a giant team, you're working with graphics, and you can kind of tell the story more with the cameras and the pictures, and you're there to not just give the play-by-play, but try and give the highlighted context of what's going on. So it's a little bit more challenging. But on the other side, for radio, I love being what the person is listening to. You simply have to give the black and white play-by-play of what's going on in the game. And it's moving fast. You're talking fast, but you're also working with an engineer typically. You're working with your color commentator. So I know it's a bunch of jumble. I don't really know which one I like better. I just love calling games and would love to do both someday. I'm not going to rule either of them out, I guess.
All right. Well, the future probably looks bright, does look bright for Adam Jaksa. All right. Let's talk a little football before we wrap up our conversation. You mentioned Coach McElwain already saying that coming to Baton Rouge has its challenges just showing up, just getting out there on the field and dealing with the atmosphere. This team coming in 1-1, as you said, really pretty good game, really good game against Missouri. Late in that game, you know, falling by 10 points last week, able to get the win 45-0 over Robert Morris. Now you come in to take on an LSU team who has also 1-1, not a great outing in week one, a little improvement in week two, but still a lot to work on. I mean, what's kind of the mindset of Central Michigan? It's a big opportunity for the school, big opportunity for the program, and it probably helps that Coach McElwain, he's been here before, and he knows a little bit of the tendency. Even though there's different coordinators, he obviously knows what it means to take on LSU. So what do you think the mindset is for the Chippewas heading south?
I think it's simple. It's win. I mean, this is a program that you're not going to see a lot of flair, and you're going to look and say it's a MAC school and it's a directional Michigan school, but CMU's been in these games. CMU's won these games. They've beaten Oklahoma State. They've beaten Michigan State three times. They've competed with Missouri. They've been in other Power 5 games. Certainly LSU's the favorite, and it is the SEC, which is the best conference in college football, but for Central Michigan, the mindset doesn't change. They expected to go down to Missouri and win. They didn't win, and that was a failure, and I think that's what CMU's heightened their elevated, they've elevated their standards because of who they are and what the football program is. So they're going to go down to Baton Rouge with the mindset, yeah, we're going to be a 20 to 24 point underdog, but we're going to go in there expecting to compete and expecting to win, and we'll play for 60 minutes and see what happens. But as you said, Coach McElwain has been here before. He's been in this conference, knows what to expect, and CMU has seen even players still on this team that are five-year guys because of COVID, that they went down to a top 25 Oklahoma State team and won in a crazy finish. They've seen what some of their predecessors have done before to go on the road and win these games against Power 5 opponents. So I don't think it's any different here. It's certainly going to be a daunting venue. There's going to be 100,000-plus people that are rooting against you, but I think CMU relishes the fact that they're going to be the underdog, and they feel like they're talented enough on both sides of the ball to compete in this game, and they want to win. I mean, I think that's what any team wants to do when they come in and play LSU or anybody in these Power 5 situations. But the MAC has been notorious for winning these games that no one gives them a chance in. I mean, we go back to last Saturday, and it looked like Toledo was going to go to South Bend and win that game against Notre Dame, a quote-unquote top 10 team here in 2021. So I don't think it's any different for a Central Michigan team that expects to compete for a MAC championship on Saturday in Baton Rouge. We'll go in the underdogs, but we're going to leave saying that we did everything we could to try and win that football game and compete against the Tigers.
All right, so let's go in real quick, little X's and O's. I know Coach McElwain at Florida loved to run some motion. He liked to move a lot of people pre-snap. I got to believe they're watching that UCLA game film from week one against LSU and probably saying, hey, let's see if we can confuse them. Let's see if they can we can make them show their hand based on where we line up. anywhere close to what you expect they're working on this week?
Yeah, I think already, as you mentioned, a lot of motions and Coach Max kind of spread attack, but they've ran Wildcat since he's been here. They've got a specialist in Khalil Pimpleton who does all sorts of things. He can run it, he can catch it, he can throw it. You're going to look at him and go, oh, he's 5'8", 5'9", but he's a little burner, and they love him having the football. He'll be back on punt returns for CMU, so they're comfortable with the ball in his hands. They feel like they've got a couple of options as well. They've got a kid in Darius Bracey who's out of Alabama. He's got good speed. He was a high school running back and quarterback. He's played both defense and offense. He's now a running back for CMU. So they've got those type of weapons to do the Wildcat formations and to give you some speed. But then they've also got the power back in a Lou Nichols, and they feel like they've potentially found a quarterback as well. So as we expect, I think, from Coach McElwain, you looked at his strengths of a former quarterback, an offensive coordinator, and then as a head coach at Florida, he's expected to have a good offense. And right now, in year three at CMU, there's a lot of good pieces on this Central Michigan offense that should be able to score some points this season, and certainly they'll get tested against an SEC defense in LSU on Saturday.
Should be a good game. Tigers certainly looking to improve. We hear week one, week two, just listening to Coach O earlier today in his press conference, he's talking about making a major jump as well, week two to week three. Adam Jaksa has been our guest. He's the voice of the Chippewas. Again, he'll be on the call this coming weekend as the Chippewas come down here to take on your Fighting Tigers of LSU. Adam, it's been a pleasure. Thank you for taking time out of your very busy schedule to join us for this week's show, and hope to see you on Saturday. We'll shake hands or fist bump, whatever you feel like doing, and have a great call on Saturday.
Hey, thanks so much for adapting to that crazy schedule, and Chris, can't wait to see you on Saturday. Thanks so much.
No doubt about it, my friend. Certainly know the feeling. All right, fans, that's another week of Hearing Voices. Glad, again, you stopped by our little show, and we invite you to do it each and every week. Thanks to Adam Jaksa for joining us. And again, if you want to follow him on Twitter, it's easy, at Adam Jaksa. Doesn't get easier than that. Speaking of easy, all you got to do is subscribe to Hearing Voices. And every time a new episode drops, well, guess what? It's right there on your favorite mobile device. We'll have coverage of the game coming up this weekend starting at 4:30. LSU game day gets our day started. Then we'll have the coverage for you inside Tiger Stadium, LSU, Central Michigan. Kickoff just after 6:30. Thanks to Adam for joining us. Thanks to you. And until next week, this is Chris Blair. Still Hearing Voices.
This is a production of LSUSP and Playfly Sports. Hit the subscribe button now and never miss a new episode. You can follow Chris at LSU Tigers Voice. The LSU Sports Radio Network, a division of LSUSP and Playfly Sports.